World War I, 1917, a year of change. For Germany, the year began with the Kaiser replacing von Falkenhayn as German commander-in-chief after the failure of Verdun with its Eastern Front generals, von Hindenburg and Ludendorff. The two now controlled the entire German war effort. Their plan was to go defensive in the west and even surrender some territory in order to occupy stronger defensive positions that they called the Hindenburg Line. This withdrawal occurred between February and April. In the east, Russia was not a great threat due to fighting in 1916, so no major actions were planned. Von Hindenburg and Ludendorff's two major plans for 1917 were 1. They would carry out a program of extensive industrial mobilization, harnessing the entire German economy for the production of war material. 2. They would attempt to bring Great Britain to its knees and knock it out of the war by an offensive wage not on land but by sea and not directed against the British Navy, but against the merchant shipping, neutral as well as allied. The U-boat, like a submarine, would be employed to starve Great Britain into surrender. These plans represented some elements of novelty, something new to break the stalemate, that could hardly be claimed for the plans of the Entente. In the east, Russia planned attacks in the north and the south. However, in the end, the Tsar decided an offensive against Austria-Hungary under the command of General Brusilov was the best plan, as it had worked well in 1916. Despite the poor state of his army and limited amounts of supplies, the Tsar was facing growing unrest within Russia at his country's lack of success in the war to this point, and he felt the need for victory as much for his country as for himself. On the Eastern Front, General Joffre was sacked as commander-in-chief of the French army, and he was replaced by General Nivelle. Nivelle had another series of offensives against Germans planned. There was a change in Great Britain too, but of a political nature, with David Lloyd George replacing Herbert Asquith as Prime Minister. Lloyd George was devoted to winning the war, but not like the style of offensives being used and planned. He did not like his commander-in-chief, Haig. He saw Haig as unimaginative and wasteful with his soldiers' lives. Lloyd George was determined to win the war, but he was not going to see the sacrifices of British soldiers that had occurred in 1916. Lloyd George met with Nivelle, and the two decided the Entente strategy for 1917. Nivelle and his French army would launch an offensive against the Germans at Chem de Dame, while a simultaneous British offensive against Germans at Arras would occur. Remarkably, Lloyd George gave Nivelle the overall command of his British troops for these offensives, leaving Haig angry and embarrassed, as he would have to seek permission from a French general before making any moves with his British army. The U-boat campaign. Germany unleashed its campaign of unrestricted U-boat warfare against all merchant shipping in February. The U-boat campaign produced spectacular results early, sinking many merchant ships. Yet the plan never came close to achieving its objective of knocking Great Britain out of the war, as early successes could not be maintained. Great Britain was able to use countermeasures, such as convoys, to decrease the success of U-boats. The only significant consequence of the U-boat campaign was entirely to Germany's disadvantage. US President Woodrow Wilson, as he had made clear would be the case, treated the destruction of US merchant ships as an act of war and entered the war on the Entente side. This news excited the Entente powers. However, the immediate infusion of fresh US troops would not occur for some time, as in April 1917, the US only possessed a small army. Wilson now had to mobilize his vast manpower and resources, as he placed General von Pershing in command of all US forces and was keen for the US army to be an independent force. Exit Russia. The planned Russian offensive against Austria-Hungary never reached the starting line. The army being prepared for this offensive was poor in all aspects, and things back in Russia were even worse, with revolutionary sentiments making themselves felt. During March and April, 2 million Russian troops deserted. While the civilian population hated the Tsar and their country's style of government, a monarchy, widespread strikes broke out, and the army refused the Tsar's order to repress the strikes. Food shortages now reached a critical level. The Tsar was forced to abdicate, and a constitutional government was formed instead of a monarch. The new government was keen to achieve military success to increase its popularity and consolidate its position that was poor in most major Russian cities. The new government instructed Brusilov to launch an offensive against Austria-Hungary. to establish its credibility. The offensive opened on June 18 and had early successes. However, as always, Germany came to Austria-Hungary's aid, and the Russian troops showed no enthusiasm to fight German troops. After 3 weeks, Brusilov called the offensive off and the entire Russian army was in full retreat. Hindenburg and Ludendorff realized Russia's poor state and launched an offensive in the north that immediately captured the Baltic port of Riga. At this point, Russian morale was disintegrated entirely. Brusilov was sacked. The army became disloyal to the new government and refused to carry out its orders. Revolutionary forces again called for a change in government style. Peasants called for a redistribution of land and a breakup of the army. The new government collapsed, and the leadership of Russia now passed to the revolutionary Bolsheviks, who believed the time was right to change Russia's style of government again and stop the war. So, communist leader Vladimir Lenin took control of Russia and sought a peace with the Kaiser. Nivelle's Day. As the Western Allies watched helplessly at the military and political collapse of Russia, their own experience proved just as discomforting. Promised US soldiers were still some time off, and the planned offensives at Chemda Dames and Arras proved to be a disaster. Only small advances by Canadian forces at Arras could be achieved, and this was under the cover of heavy military artillery in the creeping barrage style. Apart from here, Nivelle used the same offensive techniques that had failed in 1915 and 1916. At this point, French troops lost all morale, particularly in their military leaders, as Nivelle was offering nothing new. In 68 of France's 112 divisions on the Western Front, mutiny occurred, as French troops refused to follow orders or return to the trenches after time off. Much of France's frontline trenches were now sparsely defended, but Germany did not realize. The message from the French troops was clear: we will no longer fight under the same old conditions. Nivelle was sacked in favor of the French army's most popular and heroic figure, who was against another offensive, the hero of Verdun, General Pétain. Pétain restored order in the French army by carrying out 50 to 70 executions as punishments of leaders in the mutiny. He also gave his troops better living conditions and provisions, but above all, he called off any more large offensives. Under Pétain, the French army would continue to hold the line, but would not undertake anything more than an offensive under the cover of their own artillery, a set-piece battle or creeping barrage. Great Britain now had to do any planned large offensive on the Western Front against Germany alone. The Third Battle of Ypres. British Prime Minister Lloyd George gave Haig back control of British forces on the Western Front after the sacking of Nivelle. Lloyd George's reputation was dented, and Haig used this to order a new massive offensive to start in Ypres, Belgium. Lloyd George was against this major offensive and only wanted Haig to launch a series of small set pieces, creeping barrage operations under the cover of their own military, bite and hold operations. The two argued bitterly, but Lloyd George's own politicians agreed with Haig this time. After Lloyd George's politicians erred on giving Nivelle control of the British forces instead of Haig. So, Great Britain launched its own vast offensive in 1917, the Third Battle of Ypres. Haig began the operation well by using mines and shelling to remove Germans from the frontline trench. However, Haig paused at this time to reorganize his staff before his next move. This decision lost Haig his army's momentum and gave the German army time to strengthen their own defences in the Ypres area. After this pause, Haig used his normal tactic of massive bombardment of the German lines followed by an infantry advance to take the German frontline trench. As usual, this large offensive failed, and heavy rain set in, reducing the battlefield to a mire, making any offensive movements impossible. As the weather fined in September, Haig launched a series of bite-and-hold attacks under the constant coverage of his own artillery that had massive stockpiles of ammunition the British industry was able to produce, but German industry could not. These smaller offensives gained victory after victory, as von Hindenburg and Ludendorff had no answer, but each attack would be called off once the troops had reached the artillery's maximum range, which was about 3,000 yards. The rain returned, which meant that artillery could not be used. But Haig did not call off his offences and had troops attempt to advance across ground that had been turned into mud and under no artillery cover that had been so successful. Haig's troops sustained huge casualties in capturing Passchendaele Ridge that Haig had deemed a critical position to capture. Once British troops secured Passchendaele Ridge, Haig realised it was not as important as he thought it was and withdrew. Cambrai. As the Third Battle of Ypres finished, it appeared major fighting for 1917 was completed. However, both Great British and German military commands had their other ideas. Haig was looking for action in another area to provide some redemption for Passchendaele, and he noticed at Cambrai at the Western Front, the German front line was weakly held. As secretly as possible, Haig assembled troops, artillery and tanks at Cambrai. However, no reserve troops were available due to the heavy losses at the Third Battle of Ypres. This helped Haig maintain surprise, but also meant that all possibility of exploiting the surprise was removed. The Battle of Cambrai presented some good successes for Great Britain. 1. The choice of ground, free of devastation from repeated artillery attack bombardments, allowed 400 tanks to be used with great results. And 2. The artillery using maps and sound as well as sight ranges increased accuracy. This allowed the British to break the German lines with only small casualties. But due to no reserves to follow up the advancements, the Germans were able to counterattack and push the British back to their starting positions. This battle gave Haig a clue as to how to launch future operations in order to break the stalemate on the Western Front. But at this time, it only proved to be further frustration for British leaders. Caporetto. By the middle of 1917, Italy, scared of Germany, informed their partners that after many costly offensives against Austria-Hungary for little gain, they would no longer be doing any attacks in the year and would simply concentrate on defense. Germany, now having no more offensive commitments on the Eastern Front due to Russia's exit, transferred extra divisions to the Italian front and, along with Austria-Hungary, launched a massive offensive against their former ally in the closing minutes of 1917. In just 3 weeks, the Central Powers had advanced 80 miles into Italy, killing 300,000 Italian troops, wounding 750,000 and taking many prisoners. Italian troops simply turned and ran in the face of the Central Powers' offensives. It was only at the River Piave that British and French troops rallied the Italians and finally the defensive line held. Thankfully for the Entente, with revolutionary forces growing, Italy's social and political structures held and did not collapse like Russia. However, Italy was now a shaken nation like France and was left to lick its wounds and was determined not to mount further large operations. The events of 1917 sent mixed messages to all contestants. Germany began the year intending to be defensive, yet the year resulted in a total elimination of one of its adversaries and the heavy wounding of two others. Germany also did not have to fight a war on two fronts, yet not all events of 1917 were to Germany's advantage. Defensive actions on the Western Front had drained both men and materials, and the plan to knock Great Britain out of the war failed and only prompted the entry of the US. Germany also remained under heavy naval blockade. For Entente powers, the loss of Russia and the severe rocking of France and Italy were both obvious negatives, just as the inclusion of the US was a huge positive. An often overlooked positive for Great Britain in 1917 was that its army and weaponry had grown exponentially. Because its industrial mobilization and output was better than Germany's, it led to superior results on the battlefield.